In this webcast and the next, we're going to be talking about systems that have extended pi conjugation. We've already talked about the molecular orbitals of ethylene, so the next logical step would be to go from 2 to 3-atom pi systems. In other words, we need molecules that have 3 contiguous sp2 hybridized atoms. Being sp2 hybridized means that they'll have one p orbital left over to contribute to the pi system. Here's several examples of molecules that have 3-atom pi systems. There's actually many more than this. For example, you might write down the enolate anion as something that's not included in this list. Now, each of these molecules has 3 adjacent sp2 hybridized atoms, which at first glance may not be completely obvious. For example, you might want to assign an sp3 configuration to this oxygen atom. However, when you look at the resonance structure, the one that's down at the bottom, you can clearly see that that oxygen can be written as though it's sp2 hybridized. So it too has a p orbital to donate to the pi system. We're going to use the allyl cation and the allyl anion as our prototypical 3-atom pi systems. What I mean by that is the molecular orbital pictures for these other 3-atom pi systems are going to be very similar in appearance to the allyl cation and the allyl anion. You can see that the main difference between the allyl cation and allyl anion is the number of electrons in the pi system. In the case of the allyl cation, there's going to be only a 2-electron pi system, so when we construct the molecular orbitals by the LCAO method, we'll populate each of the p orbitals with 1 electron, and then we'll have 1 p orbital that's empty. In the case of the allyl anion, there'll be a single electron in each of these atoms, and then we'll consider that the third p orbital that contributes to the molecular orbitals has a pair of electrons in it. Let's begin with a qualitative approach to LCAO. We begin with 3 atomic p orbitals. 2 of them have a single electron in them, and the third either has a pair of electrons for the allyl anion or the allyl cation has no electrons in that p orbital. These atomic orbitals come together and make a new set of molecular orbitals. We can anticipate that there will be 3 of them, and we can also anticipate that their energies are going to depend on the number of nodes. 0 nodes is easy to create. We match the phases of all 3 p orbitals together. 2 nodes is pretty easy to generate because we just alternate the phase between adjacent atoms. And then we can anticipate that in between those, we're going to have a molecular orbital that has 1 node. How do we take a 3-atom system and generate 1 node? Well, we would expect that the node to be centered right on that center atom. And if there's a node, a nodal point, that means that the coefficient is going to be 0. That means that we have a sine inversion at that position, and so the value of the orbital has to be equal to 0. In other words, there is a vanishing contribution of this atom's p orbital in that second molecular orbital. The energies then will look like this. That 0 node molecular orbital will be the highest occupied molecular orbital in the case of the 2 pi electron allyl cation. The lowest unoccupied molecular orbital for the allyl cation will be that 1 node pi molecular orbital. That'll be the HOMO for the allyl anion, and that leaves that 2 node pi molecular orbital as the LUMO for the allyl anion. Here's the coefficient matrix that results from our LCAO analysis, and here's a pictorial representation of that coefficient matrix. We can note that there is a 0 coefficient on that second molecular orbital where there needs to be a node right at the carbon atom. This is a side view, and we can see the coefficients there. Here's the top view as though we were looking from that position, and we see large lobes represented by large circles. We see that the blue phase matches the blue phase there, and that the smaller lobes are represented by small circles. The phase being unshaded matches the phases of those lobes. The LUMO of the allyl cation has lobes that are large in the positions where we note the positive charge resides from the resonance contributors. Similarly, the HOMO of the allyl anion also has large coefficients on the positions where we notice that the negative charge is. LUMO, positive charge positions. HOMO, negative charge positions. And finally, the energy diagram shown here results from WebMO calculations. Remember that negative charge increases atomic orbital energies, positive charge lowers atomic orbital energies, and as a result, we see that the energy levels for the allyl cation are much lower than the energy levels of the allyl anion. Okay, now the last thing is, don't forget to visit the Darmstadt site. You'll see some great interactive graphics on the molecular orbitals of the allyl cation and the allyl anion.